No, Meg, we're eating here.
I'd like to see you try.
The University of Georgia Bulldogs just got ranked number one in the Associated Press's college football poll. It was really close. Really, really close. UGA only got 60 of the 63 first place votes. Only 60. But in all seriousness, the Bulldogs have just repeated, and it appears that most people believe that they are in line for a three-peat. Now, unfortunately for Dogs fans, some facts dispute this. No team has three-peated since Minnesota when they did it from 1934 to 1936. And if you're a real fan, even that three-peat is questionable. Also, since 2004, only two teams that started on the top of the AP poll finished in that number one slot. 2017 Alabama and 2004 USC. The Bulldogs are coming off repeating as national champions and are now the favorites to win again. There are many reasons why the three-peat is unlikely. However, there are plenty of reasons they could do it and set themselves up to create the greatest dynasty of all time. The first and most important part of this is that the Bulldogs have that next man up mentality. They had 10 players selected in the NFL draft. However, the impact returners are numerous. On defense, Javon Bullard, who had two interceptions in the national championship game against TCU, returns along with his safety partner Malachi Starks. They are both likely to be first-round picks, as is Kamari Lassiter, who has an argument as being the best cornerback in college football. He also returns. And in the box, Smile Munden, Mykel Williams, and Chaz Chambliss all return. And some of the best recruiting classes are about to step up into important roles. Freshman Damon Wilson is likely to pair with Mykel Williams and instantly become a top 5 pass rush duo in college football. Bear Alexander transfers? He is immediately replaced by 5-star Jordan Hall on the D-line. On offense, the main losses were Stetson Bennett, who got drafted, and A.D. Mitchell, who transferred to Texas. While losing your starting QB is never easy, I think Mitchell may be a bigger loss. Beck, who I have never strongly admired, changed my mind through his spring game play, and Kirby's glowing comments about him. Comments he doesn't give out easily. It has also been apparent that UGA does not need a quarterback who can carry the load, but a quarterback who just does not blow games. All he has to do is the bare minimum, and I think Beck is well capable of doing that. As for Mitchell, he is replaced by two transfers in Ra-Ra Thomas and Dominic Lovett, SEC guys who can truly ball out. They can't touch Mitchell's skill and potential. However, those two combined with Ladd McConkie, Arian Smith, and Marcus Rosemy Jack Saint are undeniably a top 5 wide receiver core in college football. Brock Bowers and Oscar Delp are also pretty good too. The next is coaching. Kirby Smart, of course, remains, but Georgia's top offensive mind was taken away. Todd Monken left to work with the Ravens, but a familiar face in Mike Bobo steps up. Bobo has been in Athens before, of course, but the best part about this was that he was with the team as an analyst last year, and thus the transition from Monken to Bobo should be easy. I've never been a fan of Mike Bobo, but he has had plenty of time to learn under great staffs, and this is his year to turn his career around. And lastly is the thing teased in the opening, the schedule. Every fan and UGA so-called hater alike will complain about this schedule. I wish it was a bit tougher, as I will likely go to a couple home games, but I also think that if a normal team had this schedule, it would not be viewed nearly as badly as it is currently. Other SEC fans will complain about the strength of schedule ad nauseum, but they often forget it's not nearly as hard because UGA doesn't have to play UGA. Furthermore, as the Bulldogs approach the playoffs, a good thing to remember is that a lot of the teams around college football have gotten worse. Alabama and Ohio State have a QB hole. The SEC East is weak due to Georgia's dominance, another reason the schedule is viewed as easy. With all of these things put together, Georgia has a good chance at three-peating. However, a three-peat doesn't necessarily make a dynasty. So why did I say that throwaway line in the beginning? Well, it's because Georgia is in a good spot beyond this year. The last two recruiting classes have been amazing. The Bulldogs got a commitment from the top QB we have seen in a while. Dylan Raiola is a five-star quarterback, ranked number one in his class by most ranking sites, something the likes Athens has not seen in the Kirby Smart era. While Kirby hasn't nailed on five-star QBs in his system, such as Vandegrift, Daniels, and Fields, it's hard to think that this generational talent won't be put to good use. And as mentioned before, UGA has never seen talent at quarterback like this before, at least recently. It could truly create a long-lasting dynasty. The best part is, Raiola's commitment is likely to further strengthen the class. And it already has strengthened the class. 3 5-star-plus players. You know of Raiola, but Ellis Robinson IV is the best corner in the class, and the best linebacker, Justin Williams, tags along with him. Now, who has Raiola affected directly? Well, some offensive players. Do you want some offense? How about the 4th-ranked tight end and the 4th-ranked tackle? We could see a three-peat this year and then some. All of this is to say, the Bulldogs are in a great spot for this season and beyond. As Dogs fans, we should enjoy the accomplishments of the last 2 years. But I also think it is important to be excited for what is coming. Because what is coming is something college football has never seen before. Thanks for watching. This has been Joseph Kopcho of Peach State Sports. Please like and subscribe and make sure to keep an eye out for further UGA videos.